the idea of Pan-Africanism. And I think that we do need to go back to a better understanding of how we can revive this, this concept that is so needed today. We don't have to call it the same name if necessary, but we do need to go back to a more holistic view of the continent and what we can do together. Because if we just take one country alone, it's very difficult. We really need to work coalitions.
Thanks, Veronique. Zukiswa, you mentioned Julius Malema earlier and the support he was getting. I mean, he is on the one hand seen as a kind of supreme populist politician. But as you say, also there's a lot of disillusionment with the ruling ANC. How do you think the South Africans are going to respond politically to this time of the lockdown and how the economic privations that have built up during the lockdown are going to be distributed?
Well, next year we have local elections, and local elections is where it really counts because that's where the mayors and the councillors are selected. And so it's going to be interesting. I think there might be a seismic shift because the people who have shown to make a difference in the communities will likely be the ones that will be put into positions of power because they're seen as caring. But just to touch on something that Veronique said, which I fully agree with and which I've often said to friends in different African countries, is that the middle class is complicit in the middle class on this continent, or people who think they're the middle class, are complicit in our own oppression as a continent. Because every time the ruling class exploits us, we make a plan. When government schools are defunded or underfunded, we put our children in private schools. When government hospitals, money is taken from them, or nurses or teachers or healthcare workers are not paid enough, we go to private hospitals. And in cases like Kenya, where I am, or other countries on the continent, people will go to the extent of flying out of the country for healthcare. It does not make sense to me that somebody who works in the Ministry of Health, who's an authority, who's any government authority, would fly out of the country to get healthcare. But as an example of that, I understand that the Burundian president has been found to be positive for coronavirus. And his wife is actually here in Kenya, despite the fact that we're not flying. Somehow, she managed to be flown from Burundi and is in Kenya getting healthcare. So these are the things that, when people recognize it, they should be able to speak out loudly and protest. And we then get together and we say, how are we going to do this? And I think Veronique is in a very good space. Her suggestion is amazing, that we use this space as artists, whether we're writers, whether we're actors, whether we're musicians. We use this space to now form some coalition where we can say, this is not okay, this is not right. And very rightly, we realize that we can't rely on our governments. The people who are in government are there for themselves. They're there to see how much they can take. Zimbabwe has just had a drama where the government got donated kits and they sold the kits.
Yep.
You know, people are sick. People are dying. We're saying we've got a pandemic. We locked down. They received the donation and they sold the donation to the Ministry of Health. So, I know the most cynical thing that can happen, but
this is terrible.
Well, yeah, the series of accusations against the Zimbabwe government for profiteering, individuals within the government profiteering on the import of grain at inflated prices from Tanzania. And this week there's been a lot in the Zimbabwean press about the son of the president, a guy called Collins Mnangagwa, Emmerson Mnangagwa, who is running a medical supply company and bringing in overpriced equipment. It's turned into a bunch of people around the world profiting from this pandemic, and that's one of the more obscene manifestations. But I wanted to raise, we've got a few more minutes left, I wanted to raise with Nana Amma an issue about Pan-Africanism, because your founding president in Ghana, Kwame Nkrumah, was very much part of that movement. And along with the Pan-Africanism, there has been this call for reparations for essentially the transatlantic slave trade and its role in the foundation of Western prosperity, so-called in terms of Western capitalism, and the need for some moral and material reckoning for that. And it's not just Africa and the West, but people like Shashi Tharoor in India has written extensively about the need for a reckoning between the relationship, particularly between Europe, countries like Britain and France, and South Asia and Africa. And part of the argument is not just the material deprivation this has resulted in, but also the moral depravity of the relationship and the failure of Europeans to understand the root of the political and economic systems on which they stand and which many Europeans have benefited from. I wondered whether you think this particular crisis that we're seeing around the world, these protests against racism and at the same time protests against inequality, are going to bring that issue of reparations to the fore, and what could be done about it?
I do think that they're going to bring those issues to the fore. I think that until, speaking for America in particular, until America comes to terms with its original sins, what was done to the free African men, women, and children that were brought here, what was done to the Native Americans that were already here, until that happens, there's nothing that's going to be right in this country. Because until that happens, you know, everything is a lie. We're all living this sort of mythology. I remember when the former First Lady, Michelle Obama, made a statement about how she was living in the White House and how it was built by enslaved people, her ancestors who were enslaved Black people. And the next day, all of these right-wing media people were saying, no, the slaves did not build the White House. And, you know, and it's like, well, who do you think did build the White House? You know, so there's this desire to rewrite history. There's this desire to say, well, Black people also owned slaves. And, you know, and to really not understand the system that has led to now. Because when slavery ended, slavery wasn't just about morality and owning people. Slavery was an economic system also. So when you say to people, you have to stop this, then where does the labor come from? You know, where does the labor that was once free come from? So they have to invent a system, and that system becomes sharecropping. And again, those same people are put at a disadvantage. And then when sharecropping and Jim Crow ended, what happens now? You have for-profit prisons where people are imprisoned, which is why so many Black and brown people find themselves at a disproportionate number in these prisons. And with prison comes what? Cheap, free labor. People who are making items that are being sold for hundreds of dollars and being paid cents, a quarter an hour, a dollar an hour. So until we start making those connections and until we start having that conversation, nothing will change because the structure hasn't changed. So yeah, I do believe that reparations have to be discussed. I know that my other country of citizenship, Ghana, and my country of birth, I know that
they have been welcoming people from the diaspora and offering citizenship. I don't know whether the citizenship is actually materialized. I've not heard of one person who's actually gone through and gotten an actual citizenship. But in theory, what they're saying is come here. This is your home. And I know that for some of the Black Americans that I've spoken to, that begins to heal some of the wounds a little bit, to know that they are being received in African countries. Because I know also that a lot of times Black Americans aren't very well received in African countries. They're seen as foreigners and Westerners. And even me, when I go to Ghana, and sometimes if I'm in a taxi, and I can hear sometimes people talking about me because I speak the languages, and they'll be talking about me as if I'm some sort of white person who's come to visit, and it's quite hurtful. And so then I have to respond to them, and they say, oh, I'm so sorry, my sister, you know. But I think that we as African people, regardless of where we are in the diaspora, have to start understanding that our plight is, in fact, one and the same. When Ghana was gaining her independence, Nixon, Vice President Nixon, he came to Ghana and he asked two Black people, you know, how does it feel to be free and independent? And they said, we wouldn't know. We're from Mississippi.
Right.
So I think that says a lot, because nobody is distinguishing when you are in New York City, whether you are Trayvon Martin or whether you are Amadou Diallo, or, you know, we are all the same. And up until we start really standing up for our liberation in all ways, economic and you know, liberation from racial discrimination, nothing's going to change. Nothing is going to change.
Thanks for that, Nana Ama. Can I get some concluding thoughts also from Zukiswa and Veronique? Zukiswa, former President Barack Obama of the United States, has said this moment is a protest against the tragic killing of George Floyd, but also a moment of hope for a new political alignment. Do you see it that way? And what particular hopes would you have? Nana Ama has just set out the need for closer union between Africa and African Americans. What do you take out of the current moment in terms of the way forward?
Well, I think because I'm an artist and I'm consistently hopeful, I would, in addition to the mention of reparations, I would really also, I think it's very important, wish that African governments, more African governments, do exactly what Ghana suggested when they did the Year of Return last year. And essentially to ensure that Africans in the diaspora, be it the Caribbean, be it Brazil, be it America, the US, know that should they choose to, they have a home, you know, and they can come to this continent and be given citizenship. And I think that makes a whole lot of difference, because a lot of my family who are in the US know that they have that. They have a home, you know, a place to go back to. So I would want that to happen. But I would also want for us to start seeing, for the privileged classes to start seeing the poorer people in our communities and see how we can work together and have systems that are a little more equitable, you know, and kinder. And this is the time where people not being able to fly out as they normally do, maybe we should start demanding that our government ensure that public hospitals are functional, with children not going to school. How my son is a very privileged child because he's able to do his classes online. But what happens to the child who's been away from school during this lockdown the whole time, and they don't have a computer, they don't have internet, they don't have all those things. How are we going to deal with it? We need to start asking those questions now and trying to find a solution.